Hey, it's Annie Drew for BBTV. Joining me today on the lockdown interviews is the White Rhino, Dave Adam. Dave, how are you doing?
Yeah, I'm very well, thank you. Are you?
Yeah, I'm doing good, thank you. How is lockdown treating you?
I don't like to say that I'm enjoying it, obviously, because it's a very bad time for a lot of people. It's a very sad time, but for me, I'm making the most of it and kind of thriving in this environment, you know, being locked in the house. I'm having to... the only thing I can do really is exercise and find ways and means of entertaining myself, and that's starting to cook. It's starting to do grown up things. So for me, it's working quite well. So yeah, I'm doing all right.
Is that what you're doing to keep busy? Just training?
Yeah, I'm training twice a day. I'm preparing my own meals and stuff, which is something I've never ever done before. So I've even started washing things after I've used them. It's amazing. Like I feel like a proper man. So I'm just enjoying being in the house and being not sure what the word I'm looking for is. Productive. I'm enjoying being productive. Yeah. So it's different, but it's fun though. It's fun.
Before lockdown happened, were you in camp? Like, were you preparing for a fight? Because were you meant to be fighting on Contender VIP show?
Yeah, I was going to fight April 4th on Mike's show. I still do 4 rounds on that show. So I wasn't really in camp. It was a 4-rounder and I wasn't training at all. I've not really done much training since I watched David Price July last year. So I was just waiting for a big fight. I was just waiting for a big fight, to be honest, to get in shape for. And I guess at this point in my career now, it's like the big fights are going to come at short notice if they come, you know. I'm gonna box the big names, but I'm not gonna get 10 weeks notice for it. If someone pulls out, I'm gonna be in, and that's where I was at. So right now, I guess I'm just keeping myself in the best condition possible. You know, just signed with MTK and Jamie Moore's training me, so things will change now. There's a change of direction, then a change of mindset, and I think the two things that I've done have really helped me with this productivity that I've found.
And so signing with MTK, talk us through that. How did that come about?
Out of nowhere, really. I just I was talking to Tommy Stalker about something unrelated to signing with him. You know, just a general conversation, and then I got talking to a friend of mine who recently signed with him, and he said only good things. And I've been managing myself really for the last 3 or 4 years, and I just thought I could do a good team around me. So I messaged Tommy and said, "Look, would you be interested in the team? Would you be interested in managing me?" And he said, "Yeah, I don't see why not." So spoke to a few of the other people there, and they said, "Yeah, we think we can do something with you, Dave." So I said, "All right, that's brilliant." So really, I just need a bit of guidance. I need someone to be able to say no sometimes, because every fight, OTs, you know, yo, I probably should turn them down. Even if I was fit, there wasn't really fights I should have been involved in. So just someone to put a leash around me, kind of, and just say no, pull back a little bit. So, I think it's going to be a really good move for me.
And moving to Jamie Moore's gym, what do you think Jamie's going to bring to sort of your boxing and also your life in general?
Well, Jamie's a good fellow, first and foremost. First of all, I look at him and I don't know him massively well, but I look at him and think he's a nice bloke. You know, my mum said to me, the first thing my mum said, "Well, Jamie Moore's a nice man." And I was like, "You don't know Jamie Moore, what are you talking about? I'm like, for?" And she was like, "No, he seems really nice." I said, "Yeah, he does." And for me, what it was, because at the time, I was over in New York watching Anthony Joshua fight Ruiz, the first fight. And we get into the arena. I got to the arena just before Khalil Algieri. And after about 5 or 6 rounds, the people around me was talking. And I said to him, I said, "I think Tommy should be getting pulled out soon. Like, it's a bit one-sided. I had a long way to go, but I'd pull him out." And they was like, no, he's still in there. I said, "Well, I would pull him out. Like, I'm a bit compassionate and I like to see things stopped early." And then Jamie pulled him out a couple of rounds later. And the person that I was with, I looked and I said, "That's the kind of man you want in your corner, you know." And me and Darren stopped working together. And after the price, I wasn't sure if I'd box or not, but I was thinking, who would I get to train me? That night in New York, really, before that, I'd even thought about Jamie training me, but that night in New York kind of sealed it for me that, you know, I'd hope he'd train me one day.
And so, obviously, you train some guys as well. Are they going to be moving across? Are you all going to make the move to Manchester?
Danny will be coming with me. Danny's turning pro as well. He's 18 on the 4th of May, so we're putting things into place now for him to turn professional. You know, I'm not sure we'll manage him right now. That's something I'm working on. I will still train him, But you know, at Jamie's gym, we've got Jack Catchell, Carl Frampton, Chancel Cameron, Rocky Field and Martin Murray, all these people that you learn off watch, and not only watch and learn from them in a boxing sense, but you know, Martin Murray's, you know, such an intelligent man and is intelligent through his life experiences, and I want Dennis to be around all that, you know, because even for me, I'm going over there and I think I'm going to open my eyes up a lot as well, you know, not just for boxing, but just educate myself in just in life, really. So it's a good move. I'm looking forward to it. And so is Danny, you know, the other two boys. One's come back to Glasgow now, the heavyweight that I was training. He had an incident, he had to go back home, but he's just doing his thing. And the other kid's staying out, he's an amateur boxer, he had 5 amateur fights. He used to live with me, but he had a baby, and I'd moved back home and he's looking after the baby, so he's enjoying that. And I said, look, be a dad and have your amateur fights, and you know, if you're ready to stay professional, you know, you're more than welcome to come back to me.
So what fights are you looking for when, you know, when everything goes back to normal? What kind of fights are you looking to sort of start off with?
Well, there's two routes I can go. I can go and try and win the British and Commonwealth titles, you know, which would be a 6-rounder with Jamie to get back in the swing of things, and then look at eliminators or stuff. Or I can get a few wins and then look at being the opponent in big fights, you know, which is probably more money. So I think in the ideal world, I'd have a 6-rounder. I'd have a rematch with the Argentinian Bracamonte that had a good fight with at Manchester Arena a couple of years ago. And then I'm looking for all the big fights then. So as I sit here right now, you know, I'd like the 6th round or the 10th round, and then I'd like to just have the biggest fight possible, you know, because you never know what's around the corner. After the prize fight, I never thought I'd box again. So, you know, financially, I guess it would make more sense for me just to jump into the big fights and be as fit as possible, give myself the best possible chance. But, you know, even with a loss, if after that fight I'm in a position to where I can box again, at least me and my family are going to be all right.
And are you, obviously, we don't know how long this is all going to go on for. There is talk they're going to start off just doing everything behind closed doors, you know, no yeah. crowd at all. Would you be fine to just start off, if you know, with big fights, just to do that and to go back in that way?
Yeah, it's funny because the behind closed doors stuff means that only British fighters can fight British fighters. You know, there'd be no foreign imports being flown over, no foreign opponents. So it'd be interesting how that works. You know, there'll be a lot of 50-50 fights, I guess, with good fighters taking on good fighters. But yeah, behind closed doors, you know, I think, you know, I've been training now about 3-4 weeks. I think ideally, I've probably, because the shape I was in before I started wasn't good. So I think it's going to take a little while for me to be fight ready, you know, maybe July, August. But yeah, the behind closed doors stuff, yeah, I'm not really fussed, to be honest. I want to box. I've only fought once in the last like 10 months, so you know, I'd like to box as soon as possible. But you know, I think that now that I'm with MTK and Jamie, they're not going to let me fight out of shape anymore, so probably looking like August time.
And do you think that the sort of the small hall shows are going to really suffer, because obviously I don't know if it's an option for them to go behind closed doors, really. I don't know if they're, because a lot of the fighters will only earn money based on ticket sales, and if there's no ticket sales, then do you think that's going to really struggle?
Yeah, I think it's hard, because if you said to me you're going to go out into a leisure centre with 1,000 other people, you know, on the back of the coronavirus, I don't think many people are going to be itching to go out, or never mind to pay to do it. So I think small or boxing, I was listening to Steve Goodwin, it looks like it's going to be 2021 by the time they think it's all going to get back going. And I love small old boxing. I love watching it. I love fighting on there. That's where my career started. And you know, my Contender VIP, they put small old boxing on. For me, it's not small old boxing. They're the best shows I've ever been to. It was unbelievable. With people dancing and all sorts. Couldn't believe it. But but yeah, I think it's gonna be a while. And I think it's a shame, because you know, small old boxing is British boxing. You know, of course you have got Eddie shows, not Warren shows, but Amity shows. Last year, you know, probably 5 or 6 smaller shows every weekend. So it's a shame, and I'm just fortunate I'm in a position where, you know, I might be able to get on these behind closed door shows with Eddie. So fingers crossed.
Are you grateful that you managed to get a fight in, like, before lockdown started? Because obviously, if you hadn't, you know, if your fight had been maybe a month or two later, then you would have not had a fight for that much longer, obviously, since the Price fight.
Yeah, the February fight, I was that was hit and that was touch and go, because the board didn't want to pass me for that either. They said for a long time wasn't medically clear to fight. So I was going to leave it, and I was thinking about it at the end of March. So, the people I feel for, the people that are in training, you know, for the mid-March, end of March time, April, even May, you know, a lot of fighters start. I meant to go spot a USIC in April, and I was good that that was off, you know, never mind a fight. So, there's lots to think of, you know, in boxing. And I've got friends who are small business owners and, you know, friends who have lost jobs and stuff, and it's a really hard time. So, it's not good, and the sooner we get back to normal, the better.
Well, the heavyweight division is probably one of the most competitive at the moment across the world, but also in Britain. In your mind, who's the sort of number one for you?
Well, Tyson Fury is number one man, isn't he? Because I like him as well. So, but he's the number one man. He just beat Wilder, and they're two of the top three. So Tyson has to be number one. You know, I think AJ's number two. Wilder's number three. Then you've got a little bit of a gap then to, you know, to the rest. And there's so many. You know, I think them top three are the real top three. I think they're universally recognised as the top three weights in the world. But beneath that, you've got Dillian White, you've got Povetkin, Hunter, Ortiz, you know, the list goes on and on. Then you got the prospects coming up like Dubois, Joyce, Yoka. You know, there's so many heavyweights about. So, you know, people say it's a great time to be a heavyweight, but not really when you're me. But as a fan, though, which I am, you know, the top level boxing, it's amazing times.
And do you think that when obviously the fights happen, whenever they will be, for the sort of Wilder Fury rematch, do you think it will be the same result?
I wouldn't be so sure. I don't think it. I think we saw the worst Wilder on the last night. I think we saw the best Tyson. So, you know, you reverse that, and you know, you definitely got at least a very good matchup. So it'll be interesting. You know, I think depending on how this goes, I know if boxing doesn't, you know, recommence till back end of the year, you know, I'd rather see Tyson fight Joshua straight away, you know, do away with the Pulev and the Wilder trilogy. But, you know, as boxing fans, we don't often get much what we want, do we? So,
do you think that the AJ Fury fight's going to happen?
I'm not sure it will ever happen, to be honest. But, you know, I think Pulev's a really good fighter. I was really intrigued about the Pulev-Joshua fight. I think it's a really good fight. You know, people say, why is he watching Pulev? But these are the same people that said Andy Ruiz had no chance. So it's a very, very interesting time in the division. There's so many good fights and good fighters about. You know, Daniel Dubois is not really far off fighting, you know, for the World Heavyweight title. You know, the winner of him and Joyce isn't far away. Yoka absolutely hammered me. And he's amazing. So, and he's not far away either. So there's so many good fights out there. You know, as fans that we are, it's great.
The Dubois Joyce fight is meant to be now happening in July, whether it will or not.
Yeah.
Who do you think will win that?
I thought Joe Joyce would win. You know, I sparred both men, and Daniel. I think Daniel will be a future heavyweight champion of the world, but. You know, he's 21, 22. He's only a baby. You know, his skill set for a big man is really good. You know, he moves really well. He's got a fantastic jab. You know, he's got good power in his right hand as well. He's clever. He's experienced. People say he only had a certain amount of senior amateur fights, but, you know, he had about 70 juniors. So he's experienced. And I think in 3 or 4 years' time, he'll probably be one of the best heavyweights in the world. But Joe Joyce right now is 33 years old. He's a grown man. I've sparred him as well, and he's super strong and fit and tough, and he's got everything really, apart from looking good. You know, he just doesn't look very good, but I can assure you he's an absolute handful. And I just think Joe Joyce at 33 may be a little bit too much for Daniel at 22. So, hello, doggy. So I think it's a really interesting matchup, though. You know, Daniel knocking out Joe in the early rounds wouldn't surprise me, and Daniel trying to knock Joe out and not being able to and getting stopped late in the fight is a possibility as well.
So what is sort of your goals once boxing is back? You know, what are you wanting and thinking you can achieve?
I want to, there's three, in boxing there's three things left for me to do. You know, I've headlined the O2 Arena, I've had some great nights there, chief support of the pay-per-view, I've done every arena in the country nearly, you know. There's a few left to tick, that's one goal. I want to go to Birmingham, I don't know why, just not boxing. I'd like to box at that arena. For me, like stuff like I've got that left to do. I want to box at Birmingham. I want to box at the Echo in Liverpool. I want to tick them all off, you know. My, might sound sad, but I want to, when I get older, say I'll box in every arena in the country. So that's one goal. The second goal is I want to be financially secure when I'm done out of it, you know. I've boxed, you heard from my record, like, you'd say, oh my God, he should be a millionaire. He's got some of the best athletes in the world, but, you know, far from that. So I'd like to finish the game with as much hype as I put in, you know, because I've been boxing 12 years now and I've had some hard fights and, you know, I want the big fights. And last of all, I would like the British title as well. I'm just not sure. You know, I'm 28 years old, but I've got a lot of miles on the clock, and I'm not sure whether winning the British title and being financially secure, you know, I can do both, to be honest. You know, I've spoke to people, and it's like, you know, do you want to be an opponent to the top names and try and, you know, pull off a rocky story and beat them, or do you want to try and win the British title? So I guess that's a choice I'll have to make further down the line. And fourthly, I'm not sure if that's a word, but fourth on the list as well, I want to make Danny a British champion as well. You know, the young lad that I trained.
Yeah.
Met him just over two years ago. Seen him in the amateur gym, saw he had talent. I said, look, you're leaving the amateur gym and training with me. And that was it. I said, we're British champion, you know. So that's another promise I'd like to fulfil as well.
Do you see yourself, after you've, you know, retired from being a boxer, do you see yourself doing the coaching? Is that what your sort of goals long-term are?
Yeah, you know, I think you've got to find the right people. You know, like Jamie said to me, he only trains people that he likes as well, you know, like he can get along with him once in the gym. You know, I've trained Danny for a couple of years, and he boxes like pretty much like me when I first saw him. I thought, oh, look at that kid. He's got big, curly, wavy hair. I thought, he looks like me when I was his age. I thought he was weird, you know, and got talking to him, and I thought he reminded me very much of myself. So that's why I started training him. So, the right kids, you know. I had the Scottish heavyweight as well. I enjoyed training him. I enjoyed training Liam, the amateur boxer. I enjoyed it. So through boxing, like I said, the financial security, I can't even drive, I've got a driver's license, so I don't want fancy cars. I don't want a massive house. I just want the security to be able to, when I finish boxing, go and do the things I want to do. I don't want to be forced into 9-to-5 or doing things I don't want to do. So that's the financial security that I talk about. You know, being able to train boxers and being able to do certain things like that.
Okay, well, we're just going to go over some of your lockdown favourites now, okay? So yeah. Things that are your favourite things while we're in lockdown. Okay, so starting off, your favourite lockdown TV programme that you're watching the most of?
I don't think I've really watched TV at all. I'm not really a TV watcher. The only thing I watched the SAS thing the other day.
Yeah.
I half watched that. But I'm a massive Peep Show fan. I think anyone that's not seen Peep Show should probably start watching it now. I think there's 9 series. Peep Show. I think it's only for certain humour. If you have the mindset of finding that kind of stuff funny, you'll really appreciate it. And I'm a bit of a geek, so I watch it and I think this is really, really funny. But someone else might not.
Did you just rewatch it?
I watch it all the time. I've probably seen every episode like 6 times, and I laugh every single time, all the same parts. So yeah, I love Peep Show. Yeah.
What about your favourite? Do you watch series? Your favourite lockdown series, like on Netflix or anything?
I mean, I things I've been watching. I watched the Who Wants to Be a Millionaire thing the other day. Did you see that?
Quiz.
Yeah, I really enjoyed that. I thought the man that played Chris Tarrant was unbelievable. Like, if I had my eyes closed, I think it was Chris Tarrant. I really enjoyed that. But my favourite, you know what? I'm not really a massive TV watcher, all on Netflix. You know, the only 3 things I can think of that I've watched in like the last 12, 18 months is Power. I watched that every episode all the way through. I watched Peep Show all the way through, and I've seen White Gold as well. I don't know if you've seen that. It's about
I've watched all of them.
And that's amazing. Yeah. So they're the only 3 things I watch.
Okay, what is your favourite lockdown meal? Like, what are you eating most of?
I'm eating the same things every day. You know, I go for my diet now because people keep asking about my diet. So I wake up at 8:30. I go downstairs from 8:25 to 9. I have a protein shake, a banana, and a coffee. And then I train, and then I come back and I have some Greek yogurt, yeah, and put some cashew nuts in there, almonds and pumpkin seeds. And about 2 hours later, I have an omelette. I learned how to make an omelette now as well. I can really work the oven in the lot. So I have 3 eggs, some ham and cheese, and a couple of hours later, I have some fruit. Then my dinner, but my sister makes that, so I'm not in charge of that. And then at night, I have like protein shake. Sometimes I have some Skittles. I'm struggling on my diet, I have some Skittles. But last 2 nights, I'm not having any, and I'm doing really well. So my favourite meal out of all them, I'm quite enjoying these protein shakes. I've never really had them before, but it's really nice. It's like vanilla flavour. It's crazy. You like put it in the blender and it tastes really good, actually.
I think vanilla, it just goes with everything as well. I think vanilla's the way forwards.
I just think I'm lactose intolerant, but I have milk and dairy and stuff, but I'd love to have it with some milk, but I think in these times, you know, you've got to be a little bit careful with the milk. I don't want my sister to tell me off because I'm taking all the milk, so I'm just having it with water.
What like meal or food sort of takeaway or eating out are you missing the most since
been I like TGI's is my thing, like that's my go-to. I like Estabulo, but they're not everywhere. I don't know if you know what Estabulo is.
No.
It's like an all-you-can-eat Brazilian where you have like the green and the red thing, and if you finish, you put the red thing down. If you want to keep eating, you put the green thing down, so people come round. Like they come round with steak and stuff, and you say yeah, and like they put like steak or whatever on your plate.
So is it like you can just keep eating?
It's like an all-you-can-eat, yeah, like an all-you-can-eat Brazilian place, but like it's just basically meat. And you get chips as well, but you can go to the salad bar before. Well, no one does that, do they? You know, you got to be smart.
We haven't got any medals.
Yeah, like, it's called Estabulo. I think they're like a northern thing, but there's one in the O2, but I don't think it's called Estabulo. It's called something else, but it's amazing. But I can't go there all the time, so I go to TGI's if I'm being a bit healthier.
And what's the first thing you're going to do when you get out of lockdown?
I don't really get any thought, you know. I've not seen my nan for a long time, probably going to see my nan. I spent a lot of time with my nan, I've not seen her for a long time now. You know, we FaceTimed for about a week and then she got sick of it, and we were just looking at her chin like this for about an hour. But probably going to see my nan, going to see my granddad, going to see Danny, train Danny, because he'll need training. I know for a fact he's put weight on, he's lying to me about what he weighs, but probably see it in three people and get cracking back on, you know, day-to-day general life.
And obviously, everyone is in lockdown to obviously stop, you know, help prevent the spread of the virus. But just to finish, what is the best thing about the lockdown for you? What are you enjoying the most about it?
I think, you know, it's given me a little bit. I've got routine, you know, because I know I can't do certain things. I can't go out. I can't go to TGI's for 3 hours and, you know, and eat everything there and sit there and with my friends, and or I can't. I never drank in my life or go out, so I don't. I'm not really one for doing activities, but you know, this is like when I was at home before. I'd sit there like two tubes of Pringles, 2 litres Iron Brew, and just eat them all. But now, for some reason, I've just got myself on like some proper regimented routine. I'm up at 8:30. But I'm not leaving. I don't leave my bedroom door till 8:35 because that's just what I've got written down. I write everything down the night before, and I stick to it the next day. And so this whole period of time, hopefully, you know, I will stick to it when things go back to normal. I hope, because I'm even cooking and stuff. I'm not home with my sisters, but when I go home, like, I might even start shopping, because usually I just eat out all the time. But I might even start shopping and cooking and stuff. I really feel like I'm a new man. I might even start like cleaning and stuff as well.
Gonna be a new you.
Yeah, I just feel like I'm 28 now. Like I need to sort myself out, really, don't I?
Having a positive effect, anyway.
Yeah, I think, like I said to start with, like I don't want to say it's a good thing, obviously, because it's not. You know, people out there, you know, the dying and stuff is horrendous, but for me personally, I proper done well, because a lot of people were worrying about me before and saying, and I know for a fact they didn't say before, but the messenger said, you know what, Dave, you really surprised me, because I was expecting you to really struggle. I thought you would blow up in weight and, you know, have certain problems. And I'm like, no, like, I'm going to be more ready than anyone when this thing's clears up and get back to normal. I'm going to, I just wanted to surprise everyone, really, you know.
Is that why you went to your sister's? Was it just to get like a change of scenery for it? Or was it just to cook for you?
She knew I wouldn't, she knew that if I was left on my own at home, you know, for 6 weeks, it would be at the end of lockdown. Like I wouldn't be around. I'd be in bed starving and crying and lonely. So, yeah, she got me down here because she knew I couldn't look after myself, you know, and that's the honesty of it. And it's sad, really, isn't it? People always say, Dave, why is an handsome man like you on your own? And it's because I don't cook, I can't clean. You know what I mean? So I'm gonna get all that stuff sorted out, and I do think it's I think it's made me a better, I won't say a better man, but it's made me I can make an omelette now, so
yeah, I'm happy. Well, thank you for speaking to us, Dave. We'll basically have a catch up. Once everything's back to normal, we'll come up the gym and have a catch up, do an interview, and then hopefully things can get back to normal.
Absolutely, yeah. And I love Aki as well. Hi, Aki, if you're watching this.
I know, yeah. He'll be gutted that I've done the interview and not him.
I love Aki.